Good morning and welcome to worship with us here at South Windsor Citadel on this Pentecost Sunday. We're so glad that you've joined us. And as we worship together, I just pray that you would feel the Holy Spirit's presence falling afresh upon you this day. Our call to worship is from the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 40, starting in verse 28. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired and weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Let's dedicate this morning to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this Pentecost Sunday and the remembrance that we spend time reflecting on and reading the scriptures of how you sent the Holy Spirit upon those first disciples on the day of Pentecost and how that empowered them and enabled them to spread the good news of Jesus everywhere. And Father, we acknowledge this day that we need another Pentecost. So Father, we pray that as we worship you and as we lift Jesus' name on high this day, that you would once again send your Spirit upon us. We thank you for this day. We thank you for your word. In Jesus' powerful, matchless name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
This morning, I think it's important in our worship service to incorporate a prayer specifically for the people, the parents, the town, the whole city of Uvalde, Texas. I'm sure, like myself, that you have been heartbroken by the footage. You know, each and every day I have the privilege of walking my children to school and giving them a hug and kiss, and I have to confess, never once have I ever had any concern that anything like this could happen. But it is a daily concern for many parents who live in the States and live in various parts, even in our own country. So let's pray together for the people of Uvalde, Texas. Heavenly Father, on this Pentecost Sunday, Lord, we pray that in a very tangible, very powerful way, that you would send your Holy Spirit upon these broken people. Lord, we can't imagine what the parents of those who have lost their children, 19 children, Lord, just innocently just killed in that manner. Father, it breaks your heart. Help it to break ours and to inspire us to fight for changes that will help protect the innocent. Lord, we think of the families. We pray that your Holy Spirit would just comfort them and draw them to Jesus. And Father, we pray for those with authority, those with the power to make changes, that you would send your Spirit upon them as well, and that it would soften their hearts to make the changes necessary. Father, we just commit this and this town and this whole city and everyone in it into your loving care this day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you. Calcutta was home to Mother Teresa, and the organization she founded, the Missionaries of Charity, continue their important work today. It's also home to the railway children. About 100,000 kids live in and around railway stations right across India. The 2016 movie, Lion, starring Academy Award winner Nicole Kidman, was filmed right in and around that main railway station in central Calcutta. And not far from there, the Salvation Army operates the VEER program for railway children who live in and around the local station. We provide food, shelter, and education. Your 2022 Partners in Mission donations enable the Salvation Army to engage in community and provide hope to those who need it most. I hope you enjoy this short video.
আমার নাম রাহুল আমার বয়স হচ্ছে 17 আমি থাকি রেলওয়ে স্টেশনে ওখানে আর কি
ওকে হিজ নেম ইজ রাহুল এন্ড হি ইজ 17 ইয়ার্স ওল্ড এন্ড হি ইজ স্টেইং ইন দ্য রেলওয়ে স্টেশন হি ইজ অ্যালোন হি ডোন্ট হ্যাভ এনি মাদার এন্ড প্যারেন্টস
আমার নাম রুবেল আমার বয়স 17 বছর আমি এখানে আসি আমার ভালো লাগে আমি কিছু শিখতে পারি
My name is Ruvel and I am 17 years old and I learned many things from here and I am able to teach some other children.
How old are you?
10. 10.
10.
10 years.
10 years. 10 years.
Tell us where you live.
कहाँ रहता है तुम ये बताओ?
ये सब्जी मंडी
ब्रिज के नीचे ब्रिज के ऊपर और ही इज लिविंग इन वेजिटेबल मार्केट और अपर साइड ऑफ द ब्रिज
एंड हाउ मेनी इयर्स इज दिस प्रोग्राम बीन गोइंग ऑन
10 इयर्स
10 इयर्स
10 इयर्स
I am teaching here since 3 years.
I am 10 years.
10 years teaching here?
Yes.
Okay, well that's amazing. Now, I understand that sometimes you actually go into the train station to look for kids and bring them here?
Yeah.
When you go and talk to these kids, you know, new kids especially, is there, you know, are they scared of you initially? Do they trust you immediately?
Not immediately, they are accepting us, but 2 or 3 days.
Scripture reading this morning is from the book of Acts, a selection of verses from chapter 1 and chapter 2. Starting in Acts chapter 1, verse 1. Jesus taken up into heaven. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote all about what Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. And after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them for a period of over 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then down to verse 12. Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. And finally, finishing in chapter 2, verse 1 through 12. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who were speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" May God bless the reading of his word to our hearts this morning.
Together in sweet peace and harmony, we
Before we reflect on God's word, let's once again bow in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time that we've set aside where we slow ourselves down and we think upon your word and how it reflects upon our lives this day. So, Father, we pray that you would give us ears to hear and hearts to understand and a will that would do what you are asking us to do. Father, we thank you for this day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Under the best of circumstances, being a parent requires the ability to multitask and a great deal of patience. With the moving truck picking up our boxes next week, and with a long list of things that need to get done before our impending move, I am finding both of these much needed things in short supply. Even at the best of times, when I have something on my mind that I feel needs to get done, I want to put everything aside and push through until that task is completed. When I have a project on the go, I don't want to be distracted and taken away from the task at hand. I want to put my head down and either finish the project or work until I'm satisfied and at a point where I can walk away to return to the project later. Unfortunately for my children, they have heard a couple of phrases come out of my mouth way too often in the past few weeks. Phrases that I would guess that none of us really like to hear. Wait a minute, and just give me a second. I'll be right in the middle of a task, whether that is cleaning out a dresser in my room or halfway packing a box, when one of our little ones will call out for something. Daddy, can you get me a drink of juice? Daddy, can I have a snack? Daddy, do you know where my sandals are? Daddy, can we go play in the front yard? Daddy, daddy, daddy. Instead of dropping everything I am doing and immediately addressing what my children have asked me to do, more often than not, the first words that come out of my mouth are, wait, wait, wait. As the pressure mounts to get things done, the manner in which this response leaves my mouth is harsher than I would like. Just give me a second, followed by a frustrated sigh. I have to give my children credit. They are seemingly handling all this extra waiting better than I would. When this move is all said and done, we will certainly have to make sure we take them to a toy store and let them pick out something as a way to show them how much we appreciate how good they have been. God has gifted me in many ways, but I must confess that patience is not my strongest gift. Oh boy, you don't want to be stuck in a car with me if we have to wait in traffic for any length of time. Waiting at the checkout line in the grocery store while the person in front seemingly price matches every single item on their shopping list is enough to make me groan as I think of the tub of ice cream in my shopping cart slowly melting. Waiting is not naturally in my skill set. Nothing gets me more worked up than having to wait when all I want to do is to keep going. You would think that as someone who likes fishing but rarely catches any fish, that waiting would be something that I would be good at by now. I wonder what the disciples' initial response was when Jesus commanded them to not leave Jerusalem but wait for the gift my Father promised. If the disciples were anything like me, I can easily imagine some of the thoughts and questions that would have been running through their heads. Wait? How long do you want us to wait for, Jesus? I'm not really feeling that safe here in Jerusalem. The religious and political leaders don't really like us, and you want us to wait here? Can't we just go back home to Galilee? Yet we don't read of any responses in Scripture that would give us the impression that disciples objected to Jesus' command for them to wait. Rather, we read that they returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives and went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Once they were back in Jerusalem, we don't read of the disciples packing up their belongings. We don't read of them each giving others hugs before heading on their separate ways. It really seems that they were intent on obeying Jesus' command. In the days after Jesus had provided this instruction, we are told that the disciples all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. I suppose our response to having to wait is often determined by who it is who is asking us to wait and what it is exactly we are waiting for. Last Tuesday, I had a dentist appointment at 10:20 a.m. to address a few small cavities, and I did my very best to make sure I arrived at the dental office on time. I filled out the necessary COVID screening form and took a seat in the waiting room. 5 minutes passed, and I was still sitting in the waiting room. 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes came and went, and there I was still twiddling my thumbs in the waiting room. It's too bad they don't have one of those blood pressure monitors in the dentist's office waiting room, as it would have been really interesting to see what my blood pressure did with every passing minute. Suffice it to say, I was not waiting patiently in eager anticipation for the hygienist to call my name. From the limited account we have, I get the sense that the followers of Jesus waited in eager anticipation for what Jesus had promised. They trusted the one who had told them to wait and were looking forward to what it was that they were told to wait for. While following Jesus over the past couple of years, the disciples had learned that they could count on his word and that they wouldn't be waiting in vain. Though through their personal experience and relationship with Jesus, they also trusted that what was being promised was worth waiting for. Some of the language that Jesus chooses to use when telling the disciples to wait, I find both interesting and helpful. As Jesus provides the command to the disciples, he says, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised." Going back to way before Jesus was crucified, in Luke chapter 11, we read Jesus also talking to his followers about the Holy Spirit. There we hear Jesus say, "Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you, then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" Jesus is, in essence, saying the Holy Spirit is a really, really good gift. It's a good thing that the disciples seem to be waiting with eager anticipation, because on the day of Pentecost, we read that suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. We are then told they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. Amazingly, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. I feel it is important to highlight the word suddenly. The followers of Jesus who were gathered together in one place on the day of Pentecost were not given advance notice that the Holy Spirit was about to be given to them. An angel of the Lord did not appear in advance to tell them to prepare themselves for a certain time or a certain day when this would happen. It appears that the followers of Jesus were already at the ready, waiting eagerly in anticipation for this gift that Jesus had promised. I can't help but wonder what role the waiting in eager anticipation played with receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. What would have happened if the disciples were not in the ready? If they were impartial to receiving this gift that Jesus had promised, would the Holy Spirit have come as it did on the day of Pentecost? I suppose the question for us to reflect on a personal level this morning, is whether we are waiting in eager anticipation for the promises Jesus has given us, his followers. In the letter to the Hebrews, the author issues a call for believers to persevere. After spelling all out all that Jesus has done for them, he issues this encouragement. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. We serve a faithful God who can do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. We serve a God whose promises never fail. Our role is to eagerly wait and trust that indeed his promises will come to fruition in our lives. Are we waiting in eager anticipation for the promises Jesus has given to us, his followers? Are we waiting in eager anticipation for the promise of his return? Or have we grown complacent with the way things are? Tired of waiting, assuming we know how each day will unfold, with little able to surprise us now. Do we feel nervous or even intimidated by the thought of the gift of the Holy Spirit falling on us? Have we ever thought of the Holy Spirit as a good gift? More generally speaking, if we were honest with ourselves, did we enter into God's house this morning, into worship this morning, eagerly anticipating the Holy Spirit moving in this place or wherever we may be? Did we wake up excited this morning, anticipating meeting with God and hearing him speak to us here at this moment? Friends, Jesus loves you. Jesus cares for you. He longs for you to live your life as his follower abundantly. And as such, he wants to give you a helper, a gift that will enable you to do so. The Holy Spirit is that gift from Jesus that helps us to effectively live our lives as his followers. We see on the day of Pentecost that the Holy Spirit filled the followers of Jesus and enabled them to declare the wonders of God to people in amazing ways. In addressing the crowd, Peter tells them that the gift of the Holy Spirit is a promise for you and your children, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. This is a promise that we can claim this very day. When we turn from our sin and dedicate our lives to becoming Jesus' followers, we will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Jesus can be trusted. Jesus is faithful to his promises. What are you waiting for? May we continue to wait, not in frustration or exhaustion or hopelessness, but may we wait eagerly anticipating all that God has in store. Please allow me to guide you in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you this day, on this day of Pentecost, and we thank you for your promises. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, a gift that enables us to live as Jesus followers, full of abundant life, enabled and empowered to live the life, to witness to others as you want us to live. Father, we thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, who is our helper, who gives us strength to overcome temptations. And Father, we thank you that the gift of the Holy Spirit is available to each and every believer who repents, who turns away from their sin, who trusts and believes in Jesus, his sacrifice on the cross for their salvation, and dedicates their lives to becoming his followers, that they can ask and you will be faithful in giving your Holy Spirit. So we pray this day that once again, your Holy Spirit, that we would come humbly before you and ask for a fresh encounter with your Holy Spirit this day. Lord, we need another Pentecost this day. We need your followers to be baptized by your Holy Spirit so that we can go forth and share the wonders of all that God has done and all that God is doing. We thank you for Jesus, who makes all of this possible. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you for worshiping with us here at South Windsor Citadel. We're so glad that you've joined us on this Pentecost Sunday. And please, if you would like to know more about receiving the Holy Spirit, if you'd like assistance or someone to just talk to you about how that goes about, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. We would love to help you in this journey of faith. Our call or benediction this morning is from James chapter 1, verse 17. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like the shifting shadows. Go receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit this day.
To smile, he came to bind the broken hearted and God and man to reconcile.
Once again to smile, he came to bind the broken.